Thanks to the NeuroTech India team for inviting me here. It's my pleasure to share my experience and the journey. But at the same time, I wanted to bring in both the research aspects of neuromodulations and NeuroTech and the product slash entrepreneurship aspect in this segment. So I wanted to caution even our young young entrepreneurs who are getting into the journey of NeuroTech. And possibly I'll end up with telling what were my strategies to go through it. And of course, entrepreneurship journey is generally a pain, and the journey in NeuroTech is at least 100 times more painful than the normal entrepreneurship journey. So let me give you a whole idea of, give you a flavor of both success as well as failures, and how do we really look at things from there, right? So guys, I know like most of you are from this forum and you may know what is neuromodulation, but just for people who may not know, I'll just try to give you a brief idea of what is neuromodulation before we start going with my talk today. So basically, neuromodulation is any technique where we are trying to give some kind of stimulus such that the normal neuronal pathway has a modulation which could actually help in suppressing some kind of pain signals or some sort of signal, or in some cases boosting the signal, right? In both the ways it could work. And there are like a lot of modalities or lot of ways you can go for neuromodulation. Like for example, ultrasound could be used, photobiomodulation could be used. You have other options like electrical stimulus. In general, people call it as TENS and NEMS and things like that. TENS is transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulus, and NEMS is similar to that. It comes into magnetic aspect of it. So there are so many types of modulation, and it could be done both invasively and non-invasively. So if you look at some of the famous invasive neuromodulation system, could be like of deep brain stimulators, spinal cord stimulators, vagal nerve stimulator. There are so many possibilities, and there has been a lot of progress in that segment as such. And basically, in theory, there are two games that we play here. Technically speaking, neuromodulation can have n number of applications and can solve n number of issues, because at the end, your whole body is being controlled by your nerves, right? So we could do a lot of things in neuromodulation. However, there are two schools of thoughts around it. School one, agrees that yeah, neuromodulation could work, and probably there is good scope of it and things like that. And second school of thought, it's like it's kind of yet another acupuncture in their language, right? So basically there are two schools of thought, and we need to be very careful on how do we scientifically prove it. And like at the end of the day, it's all about evidence-based medicine. So it's a hard journey, but at the same time, very fulfilling journey as well. So that's all about neuromodulation. You can read a lot. There is a lot of lot of things around neuromodulations everywhere, and you could go about it. A lot of work has been done in the Western world, but in India, we have done some of it, but not a lot, right? We are still catching up. So, but that's probably something good, because we may come up with some solution which could actually help reverse innovation, thereby lower the cost of the whole technology rather than having a high cost, right? So there are good opportunities around this space. So now diving into my topic today and what I want to talk about it. Before I tell you about what I have done, what I'm currently doing, let me start with the whole flavor, and at the end, let me tell you what I have done and what I have been doing. Okay, so now to start with, it's always good to start with a story, and success stories are the fun to learn about. So we'll start with a success story as well, and from that we'll go ahead. So now, if you see the most recent news for a success in neuromodulations has been basically a company from Israel who has some base in US, and they have developed a good looking you know, very fancy variable brain neuromodulation system, and the major thing that it plays is for migraine, right? So that's the small device that they have developed where you can wear it over here. So many people have migraine, including me, right? And it's very difficult to control a migraine. You eat, you know, kind of medicines, drugs and all. And many times those pain relief drugs at the end are opioids and, you know, leads to addiction and things like that. And it's a big issue going on in US at this point of time and many part of the world as well. But US, it's been projected well. So basically, it's a huge issue, and a lot of people are affected by migraine. And this company called as Neuro Relief has come up with a good system which you can actually just wear it in your head, and it would actually send you some signals, and there would be a mobile application which could control and give you some data, and it helps you helps with modulating the signal, stimulating certain nerves which they have mentioned in brief. And that helps in probably suppressing the migraine and making you help with pain, being pain-free. However, it's a success story. FDA recently approved, I believe it was approved on March 5th or somewhere end of February 2021 when this device was approved for use. However, let's look at their story. And that's what actually will give you a flavor that it's for a long haul and it's not a short haul thing, right? Now, the founders of this company had a successful exit with a company called as Ness. So Ness is neuromuscular electrical stimulator, if I'm right, something like that. So you can just Google on Ness. They got a $75 million exit from that company. And so they started some work, they did something in neuromuscular space, it was sold off. But when after the person who purchased it exited Ness, the founders were now free to work around in an area by not kind of overlapping or looking at the IP aspect of it. And they started this company in 2013 after they already had a good experience with neuromodulation in the first company. So now when they started in 2013 after a successful exit with $75 million in pocket, in 2013 when they started, they took a $5 million venture fund. And that's the money that they started with. They started to develop the product. And this product was developed by 2017-18, right? Of course, while developing, a lot of initial clinical trials were going on because a lot of regulatory aspects comes into picture. And then, basically after that, only recently with a lot of multi-site clinical validation, finally US FDA has given them the approval in last month, right? So that's the story. So if you see here, a founder who had an experience with neuromodulation in the past, took about 8 to 9 years for the product to get into market, right? With an experienced team. So if you go and see the team of Neuro Relief, amazing team that they have, right? From a product manager from 3M to, a very good team they have. You should go and look about them if you are interested. So basically, a good device which can solve one small problem in neuromodulation space takes about roughly 7 to 9 years. So that's the kind of deep tech we are talking about here. And as I told you, the bigger component over here is not about developing the solution. I believe that was the easiest part, but the biggest component is getting it into market. So after you develop your proof of concept or prototype, which actually could solve the issue, the whole cycle of regulation and everything takes a long time. And that's where you invest a lot of operational cost as well as overall product development cost, right? So that's the first thing. It's a success, but I'm just giving you the first caution about it. Now, if we go ahead and look at neuromodulations further, right? So basically, one of the major applications that we know in neuromodulation is pain management, right? So chronic pain management is a huge thing. Roughly, if you look at the pain medicine that comes into the market, overall, they just like the pharma companies to spend a lot of money in the research for pain medicines. At the same time, a lot of people buy them as well, right? So, and plus many of them get addicted as well. So it's a huge issue when it comes to pain management. And as we know, since pain is basically a signal which is carried by nerves, neuromodulation could actually be a good solution for it, right? So you talk about right from your back pains to your migraines to your, you know, pains in your foot, so on and so forth. So you have a lot of options around that, that where we can look at it. Now, if we look at the whole research aspect of it, a big opportunity for everyone to be here, right? So right from what we talk about brain control interfaces to right from a kind of advanced limbs, artificial limbs, which could actually sense your electromagnetic signals and then do actions. So there's a lot of opportunities when it comes to research. So if you are getting into that track of research and trying to look at solutions of how to solve it and the whole research around it, amazing opportunity. But even if it is research, please do understand that these are not, you know, a research where you will be doing it for 4 years, 3 years, 5 years to get your PhD. It would be a long haul for you to really get some data and prove something in this particular field. That's the whole reason why even TENS, which was, I believe, invented, I don't know when, I forgot the dates and year right now, but way long, at least 4-5 decades back when it was started, and still today we don't know its potential applications. We still don't know what are the drawbacks of TENS. We still don't know how beneficial it is. We still don't understand the mechanism of how it treats, how it rehabilitates. I'm just talking about one small device which you can get it for probably less than $50 to it can go up to $500,000 as well, $500 to $1,000 as well. But even that kind of a small device, people still don't know the entire aspect of how does it really work in your body. So amazing opportunity over there. And plus, I know a couple of people working in Arizona State University and other places where they're trying ultrasound to be used for neuromodulation and pain management. So and then again, there is a magnetic TEMS, transcutaneous electromagnetic stimulator, if I'm right. So huge opportunity over there as well for research. And mind you, please take a small area, finish it off. And if you're doing a PhD, get out of it. But if you're doing a proper research with a big team, then it's an amazing opportunity, but requires a lot of burning of money for both human resource as well as the experiments and validation. So I'm just giving you the caution here itself. Even if it is a research, it requires a lot of money. Though I'm telling a lot about money, but trust me, it will all come together when I get into some later aspects of it and talk about my journey as well. So it's a very critical component in the whole research aspect. So research, no doubt, it's an amazing field. A lot of things can happen, and probably it can solve some really pressing problems. However, please don't go by just some news telling that this can solve this. Though in research it could solve, translating the research to product is all about another big game that we are playing about, right? So that both have two different aspects of it. Now, if you look at entrepreneurship and products, that's where, I have to really caution anyone who is getting into product development and around neuromodulation. It's a very hard journey. So as I told you in the start, if entrepreneurship is tough, entrepreneurship in neurotech, especially looking at neuromodulation, is 100 times tougher, right? Because you're not only talking about developing an intervention, but you're getting into the whole thing about clinical trials, clinical validations, so on and so forth, right? So there are but some strategies which I'll talk to you in about another 10 minutes, like what all are the possible ways how we could handle it. But let me here tell you about my journey, and that would actually tie up with the finance aspect I'm talking about. So my journey with neuromodulation started in 2010. So in 2010, I was finishing my bachelor's in biomedical engineering. So I took up a project on stroke rehabilitation. So we were developing a dynamic splint, which basically could sense the motion, sense the signals of those a hemiplegic patient, and based on the signal, it would actually stimulate and help them move, rehabilitate their arms and slowly get out of the issue. So that was the whole project that we were developing. Of course, we were successful in it. We got a couple of awards from IEEE and things like that. So that went really well. However, it was just my graduation project to get my degree. I finished it. I quit. I finished my studies. I went for a job. I was working, I was working in the area of interventional pain management, incidentally. So where we are talking about radio frequency nerve ablation. So we would actually put in a small. There would be a minimally invasive surgery where we'll put in a small needle, and instead through that we'll be putting a electrode, and we'll be stimulating. We'll be ablating the nerves so that the pain gets reduced temporarily for 3 to 6 months. So that was the product that I was working on. Of course, it was fun. I was really enjoying it, roaming around the world. Almost traveled the entire India, right? So it was fun work to do. But that's when my life changed, because suddenly what happened is my mom got accelerated case of diabetic peripheral neuropathy. So basically, her right leg completely got numb. She was in pain. She couldn't walk. And her condition was really, really miserable. And that's when I took a plunge. I wanted to develop a product for her so that she could actually use it and get well. And that was the whole idea when I took a plunge, right? So I left my job. I joined my master's. Luckily, I cleared a exam called as GATE in India, where you get some stipend and support from the government of India to your master's. So I did that for the lab support that I would require to develop the whole thing. What I did is, since I had to just restart my earlier work on stroke rehabilitation, because that was also neuromodulation, and I knew that neuromodulation could possibly help, and that time there were no studies telling that nerve stimulation can actually help in reversing or rehabilitating neuropathic patients, and that was the time when I was starting to do it. So we took the we made a first proto. Of course, we tested and did all the safety tests in the lab. And when I gave it to my mom, first 4 weeks when she used it, she didn't respond to any stimulus. Right, it was just like stimulating her nerves, but she didn't know what's happening. She didn't know even if the electrical pulses were passing on her leg. But of course, when I touched, I knew that there is something that's going on. But 5th week onwards, she started to move her toe, and that's when we saw the first thing happening where it actually worked. The whole neuromodulation aspect worked, and we could see basically her toes moving, her toes in her leg moving, right? So that's where we saw the first kind of success with neuromodulation. And it was not a regular tense, by the way. It was not, we were not trying to develop a regular tense, because there were a lot of drawbacks with tens with regards to heat and all those issues. And so we were actually trying to, I can't disclose a lot because there are some IP going on around it. But what it used to do is, it used to sense the body impedance. It used to sense the various conditions around the electrodes. And based on those conditions, the algorithm used to tweak the pulse. And that was the pulse which was being delivered continuously. So she used to use 20 minutes a day, and that worked well, right? So after 1.5 years of development, so basically we developed, it was a small, I'm not able to find any box here, but yeah, it was like very small red colored tiffin box that I put in, and where I put in all my electronics in it. So prototype took just 1 year. My mom started feeling better. We thought, wow, wonderful. If we could help customize the whole product and actually help one mom, we should actually go for and try and help many more. So that was the whole intention when we went ahead and started our first startup, Fiesta Innovations. So it was just a group of my friends who had done biomedical and computer science in the college. So we joined together, we started a company, and we were like, oh God, wow, it's a great achievement, great invention, so on and so forth. So you know how a person who just graduate can really think, right? So that was my thought at that time. And we went ahead, we started a company, we started to work, and that's when the reality stuck, that just one prototype, no one is going to fund you, right? No one is going to believe in you, that why can you really go ahead and you know, be successful. I saw Sanwar basically in the this thing. I know Sanwar through a fellowship that we had, so he can talk to you about what is entrepreneurship given his successful exit from his company. You need a whole lot of analysis and a skill set that could complement to really make it happen. So making the product is probably the easiest thing in the entire entrepreneurship journey. Post that, everything is very, very, very tough. So trust me when I say it's very tough. It's like 100 times tough when it comes to neuromodulations and neurotech. So we were like all pumped up and everything. Somehow we, you know, kind of played around and tried that we'll do something good and blah, blah. Of course, we were lucky that we were getting some support. But of course, that was not enough to really go, because money becomes the biggest critical aspect. Everywhere you do validation, you'll need money. Testing, you'll need money. You need money for your operations, human resource. It just goes on and on and on. And it's not like 6 months you'll put in and scale up and suddenly from 1 year you'll get funds. No. And when I'm talking about 2012-13, even BIRAC, which is a Department of Biotechnology initiative from Government of India, they were not active at that time. They were just about to start their big grant in 2013-2014. I mean, and I'm talking about 2012-13, right? So that was a scenario. And plus, we were at that time in a place called as Coimbatore and Chennai. And of course, that time, it was not so evident that we knew which grants are available and things like that. So we couldn't go for it, and we didn't understand how to go for it and how to fully project it and look at it. So at the end, what happened is we did some informal validation on about 300 patients by showing that the specification that we derived are substantially equivalent to existing products in market. And using that route, we convinced a hospital to support us and look if it is only for my mom that it worked or it could work for many people. And we did a informal validation for about 300 patients where we actually gave them the stimulus and see how it worked. And all of them were actually in pain, right? And we had our own protocols that we had followed, that these are the people who will be actually getting the device. And we'll see, and there would be some group where it will be placebo, and then we'll compare. And that was a small experiment that we had. We got a good result. About 88% to 89% people were happy with the results, and we were like, wow, that's amazing, right? But overall, as I told you, entrepreneurship is a very big game. It's not like, especially neuromodulation, that yeah, you develop a product, you develop a prototype, you just try on 300 beta users and go, no. Unlike your hardware or SaaS platform where this could have worked, when it comes to neuromodulation, it has a lot more challenges because this is an interventional product. It's not a diagnosis product or a, you know, screening product or something which could support treatment. No, this is an interventional product. So that thereby a lot more things had to be going around. Which generally most of us don't understand, because as an engineer, it's easy for us to build a product, right? So that's what happened. We had to finally, we gave a good try multiple places. We were getting some awards here and there, of course, but it was not enough, right? At the end, you need to sustain and you need to go about it. And that's when things went south, and we had to finally shut down the company in 2016-2017 time. So that's how tough that journey can become. It will have its own highs and lows, but mind me, highs are very few and lows are, you know, really, really high. So you need to be very, very clever in strategizing your entire journey. And at the same time, if you don't have your own money, you need to really be aware, like, how are you gonna fund this project? Because at the end, if you don't have the fund, you are not gonna get it, and small amount of fund doesn't help, right? So you need to know like how that small amount of fund that you may have can add value and accelerate your growth. So be very careful and very, very mindful while planning your neuromodulation or neurotech startup. So that's my first advice on entrepreneurship and the product part of it. But however, let me also tell you some pitfalls, and let me give you some caution before I talk to you about strategies and opportunities that we could actually look at, rather than always seeing the negative aspect of it. But if you look at pitfall, of course, time is one big constraint. It's not a short game. It's not like, you know, you develop a prototype and within 1 or 2 years you can achieve the growth. No, even if it is substantially equivalent, it will take some time. So you need to really put in your calculations right and see how much money and how much time you need and be realistic. Because at least if I tell you my story, I know that even if we developed a circuit, we developed a PCB, everything, out of 10 times, 6 times it won't work. And we will have no idea why it didn't work. It's like same component, same PCB and everything. Of course, later we understood that that's because there is something called as quality management system through ISO 13485, where vendor management becomes very critical and you need to channelize your components very, very carefully through known vendors, where you can trace the components back to the manufacturer and not just go to your local store and buy it. So that we learned a little later. But as I told you, like, you have to be very, very careful in budgeting all these things. The whole game comes with budgeting. Second major important thing is collaboration. So when I say collaboration here, I'm not like joking about collaborating with hospitals, but I'm talking about serious collaboration with foundations, research institutes, your own college or alma mater possibly, right? And then a lot of hospitals, so that if you could look out and way where without spending much, collaborators add value to your product development, right? So you need to be strategically looking at it. Of course, there would be delays. So you need to budget those delays as well, because whenever you're talking about research, academics, etc., there would be delays for like examination, this event, that event, this surgery, that surgery. Just keep going on, right? So second aspect that I would say is cautioning you is about the time budgeting that we do with collaborators, and at the same time look at things as well on that aspect. A lot of your work gets done through collaboration, but it takes time. So you need to have your patience. So you need to have a method where you sustain yourself and your team while you are building this product. It's not like you're gonna just get your VC fund and you can go for it. No, this is not that game that we are playing. So be careful when it comes to interventional neurotechnology. That's my second caution to you. Third, I would always say that we always have the biggest thing that I would say for such long journey is motivation. So what motivation is there with you that holds you for this particular product development? It's not easy, by the way. So if you're talking, as I told you, I started my journey with Neuromodulations in 2010, and I've been building full-time entire product range from 2012, so it's almost a decade now, right? And only thing that holds me accountable at the same time, you know, motivates me to go on is that I have seen a success story in my mom, and I know that it has a big opportunity. Only thing is I need to hit the nails at the right spot at right time. Of course, now I am in a way better position than I was, let's say, 4 or 5 years back, right? So that's the biggest caution. It's a long haul. So what motivates you? Or you need to strategize separately, which I'll talk to you in the next slide. Like, how could you still build even if you don't have that big connection with the problem? So that's where the connection with the problem becomes really, really critical. Finally, financials and funding, we can always keep talking about for ages together. But then we need to really figure out how to get our work done with no to low money in your hands, right? So that's one of the biggest thing, is especially in India. Or else you need to be in a research lab where you are doing that as a research project, and then once the research kind of takes a good shape, you translate that research into product. So something like that you need to do. So you need to have your own strategy to sustain and develop the product. So be very careful when you get into this journey, and don't just jump into it, is my only thing. Though you can see a lot of opportunities, be very careful, especially in entrepreneurship. Even for research, I'll say the same thing. It's not easy game. Getting the approvals for your, right from your animal trials to this thing, is not easy. So even for research, you need to be really patient. Again, getting your protocol ready for clinical validation is tough. and that too for small changes. I'm not even talking about for a full product. So be very careful and be very mindful on the time that is required to develop such things, right? Now, when I say opportunities and strategies, this is where things actually become fun. Here is where you have to put your thinking cap on how to achieve it, right? That's the whole game, how to achieve it. And that too in the scenario where you have low to no resources. So you need to really think out of the box. It's not like, you know, you will tell that what I'll do is I'll build my product and I'll do some service startup in the side. Seldom works in the initial stages. Probably in the later stages, post your 5-6 years, yeah, it may work. But in the initial stage, when you're developing a very serious product, it doesn't work. So you can't actually have a service startup and you do this. It's kind of, I don't know, some may do it, but it's a very, very, very difficult ball game to play with. So you need to now strategize, how do you enter the market without spending so much of time and still getting money in the bank so that it could actually become an incremental innovation leading to finally what you want. So you have to divide your product such that in the first stage, it has an easier market entry with lower barriers on regulation, lower barriers on other thing. Then you iterate, improve. So as you get your profit, as you get your further investment, as you get your further grants, you can do it. So you need to really look at things in a stratified way and very structured in approach. And you cannot go for like, okay, directly I'm gonna make something which is gonna do this thing. It's people can do it, but very difficult job. Or you need to have a very big kitty in your hand so that money doesn't stop you. At the end, money becomes a bottleneck. And I could tell you from my experience that when money doesn't work come for a long time, even your team starts getting to get disbanded, right? So it's a very, very, very critical component in the whole picture. Though they may be motivated everything, but at the same time for survival, you need money, right? So you need to really balance this act. So how do we look at these strategies, right? So easiest way is, can you build around your technology something which could probably do a screening of a disease? You need to be focused on the disease. If you tell in the initial stage to people that, yeah, you are making a device which could work for this, in the initial days, no one is going to support you because it's too good to be true for them, right? Though it could actually work, but for them, it will feel like you're not focused and so many other things. So in the initial days, you need to talk about focus. You need to talk about one small thing your device is going to do. It could be and avoid the intervention space in the start. You can eventually build your interventional product in 4 to 5 years time, because by the time you may have launched your 3 or 4 products and the money gets in your increases your valuation, you get some funding from your PE or VCs or any other sources that you are looking at. And then you can incrementally reach your interventional product of your dream in like say a couple of years. But then, as I told you, it's a strategy for entrepreneurship. So where you could actually look things in a microscope and see what is the smallest thing that I can build and add value to the ecosystem, right? So that's the easiest way how you could do an entrepreneurship within this space. And in the research also, I would say the same thing. Please target the smallest thing that you could do in your research, which could give you a new finding and your probably a degree or whatever you are trying to do at that particular time. So your focus and your scope of work is the most critical aspect in strategizing how do you go about your overall product development. As I told you, it can be a very big dream, but you need to really plan your dream and map your project to go there. So that's what I would say. But in opportunities, of course, there are huge research opportunities right from quantifying pain. So we are looking at that space as a company where we are trying to quantify pain in some time. But it's a huge issue about quantification of pain, because interventions cannot be really developed without understanding the pain aspect of it. So your pain pathways are still being studied. So a lot of opportunity around there, both invasive and non-invasive. Plus there are a lot of issues of nerve degeneration due to the aging population. So now if you see globally, most of the countries have a higher number of aging population, which actually leads to a lot of burden to the economy due to the healthcare cost that comes around it. So a lot of scope around it. So be careful around that. The opportunities are there, but then choose the smallest thing that can actually add the most value, both for you and for the ecosystem. Only then it could be a sustainable thing, right? So if you start thinking very big, good, but present to others in a very, very small way. You can always present your vision, that's fine. But what you are doing should be a small aspect of it. So that's one of the key things that I would like to tell and give you a caution around. Pain research has been there for a while and you need to look at it, it becomes easy. So now I'll just quickly kind of wrap up talking about where am I in this journey and what can you expect to hear from us hopefully in a very short time. So basically, as I told you, our first startup, we had to stop in 2016-17, right? I was doing my PhD at IIC Bangalore, like I'm about to finish hopefully soon. We never know when we finish PhDs, but yeah. The whole idea for my PhD was to understand the mistake and look at the strategies of how to go about it. So luckily, I had a good supervising team and things like that who supported me in looking at it. So we developed a framework which could actually help in developing innovations around this space. Hopefully that would be also published soon. So you'll all have a look at it once it comes out. But then the whole idea that we started is my life again changed with Ink Talks, where I actually spoke to someone who really changed my views and wanted me to look at all this work once again after a break of 1 year. And we started our company once again. We started to look at things we didn't, of course, what we built is very critical. So that becomes the base of our new company. But then we started to look at things, as I told you, in a structured way, such that we started entering into the wellness space and we decided that we'll be building incrementally and finally reaching the space where our medical technology, our intelligent platform that we're developing could monitor progression of neurodegeneration, prevent neurodegeneration and support intervention as well. So all the three gets covered, so a completely holistic solution. But the first product that's going to come out hopefully by mid of next year is a wellness footwear that we have developed for Intel with sensors in it, which could actually quantify a lot of components around neurodegeneration, and our digital twin models and AI models that we are developing would actually look into the progression of neuropathy, Parkinson's and some diseases around that. So it's basically, we have developed a platform product now, which is highly scalable. And in fact, this whole platform would also be opened up with an API access to other people in the neurotech space who could actually plug in their hardware system and use our models to actually develop there easily, right? So that it could be an accelerated development and we could work as an ecosystem. So that's where we are heading towards. Hopefully you'll be hearing a lot from us soon in next couple of months. We would be finishing our minimum viable product by hopefully May end if Corona doesn't disrupt the whole journey again. But however, we are in exciting times now, exciting space. But at the same time, as I told you, the whole lesson that I learned is really have a structured journey, and the best thing that you could do is plan well, right? So finally, thank you for the time. I guess I've taken 40 minutes, which was allocated to me, and do feel free to reach out to me for any sort of collaboration or any sort of co-research that we could work on. We'll be happy to listen with work with you and see how things can be built with a mutually beneficial scenario. I have put in my email ID if you would like to really reach out. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you so much.
Yeah.